Hello, everybody, and welcome to the 23rd episode of OGT Live. We are really excited to have you guys join us. We also have a killer sampler that is happening tonight. We've got Andy, Curtis, and Vern here in the studio watching along with us. And so I would like to invite you to join us in a cigar and join us in a drink. And to tonight, to kind of kick off the Southern Draw sampler that we're having, I'm smoking the Manzanita. This is the newest release from Southern Draw Cigars. Phenomenal stick. We did a tasting night for it. It's got a great Habano wrapper. I'm not going to get too deep into the blend because we've got Robert Holt of Southern Draw Cigars joining us this evening. And he's going to give us probably a lowdown on that. And I'm really excited to delve into it. So we've got also Josh jumping on saying hi. Brian, hey, how's it going? So like I said, if you are smoking or you are drinking anything to pair it with, please drop in the comments. I'll pull it up for you. To get a look at tonight's sampler, this sampler pack is pretty awesome. It has some of the most popular and favorites here in the shop, that being the Desert Rose Lonsdale. The Desert Rose Lonsdale, if you have not had this stick, it is amazing. It's one of those cigars that like just completely pops. It's creamy. It's sweet. You put it with coffee in the morning, and it's just a beautiful experience. Then, of course, you have the Rosa Sharon Toro, which is a favorite, the most popular out of the line here at Oakland Tobacconist. The new Manzanita, which I'm smoking here in the middle, and then both Jacob's Ladders. Now, the Jacob's Ladder has that boldness, but also has that hashtag of bold but approachable. And so it's one of my favorite Maduros to have. I was very close. I was trying to figure out what to smoke along with Robert this evening. And I almost picked up a Jacob's Ladder, but I probably smoked too many of the Jacob's Ladder. So I was like, you know what? I should probably give it somewhat of a difference tonight. And so go with the Manzanita. So we also got Roy jumping on. Hey, Roy, how's it going? We have Andy saying, enjoying a Rose of Sharon with Old Forester. And then, oddly enough, that's what, with no small coincidence, that's what I'm going to be pairing as well. So thank you again for joining us. If you get a chance, hop on our website. You can click on the link in the video that will direct you to our website. That is where you can pick up the limited supply of our sampler pack, but it's definitely one to check out. Southern Draw makes amazing cigars, comes out of Nicaragua from AJ's factory. Absolutely love them. They're one of the first companies that we brought in as a shop here at OGT. So without any further ado, I know I can get somewhat long-winded. We're going to have Robert Holt join us from Southern Draw. Hey, Robert, how's it going? Thanks for being with us.
Hey, I'm doing better, and I'm honored to be here. I awesome. Have to substitute for Miss Sharon because she's in transit right now, trying to get back to the office in the warehouse. So we're just going to make do with Robert for now.
No, we love having you on. I think the last time I spoke with you was Instagram Live early of last year when the crazy times were even crazier. So thank you for joining us. And I have to say, thank you for the creation of this Manzanita. Phenomenal stick.
You know, I've got mixed emotions about it. I'm smoking it as well. I'm not a Gordo guy. Most people know I'm a Lancero, Lonsdale, Corona, Gordo, 40 to 46 ring gauge kind of guy. But there's two cigars in our line that I can smoke in a size that we must have, and that is the 6.5 by 60 Gordo. And this is one of the two that I can really enjoy the entire experience, even in a big ring gauge, which is, it's just not for me, you know, but I'm enjoying it. And I anticipated that you might smoke one tonight. So I thought, hell, I might as well join you.
There we go. There we go. Now I notice a lot from your guys' Instagram and a lot of your posting. Oftentimes you'll see in the foreground, some kind of drink that you pair it with. Do you have some favorite pairing drinks to go with the Manzanita that you've experimented with?
You know, of all the blends, this is the one that I really haven't made an effort. And really it comes down to this. We launched it in late December, kind of a teaser, if you will. We put out on Instagram, we said the first 10 retailers that say yes, you're going to launch the Manzanita with us. It happened quickly. And then, of course, May, June, we released Robusto Toro Gordo to all of our valued retail partners. Now, what most people don't know, Eric, is during that time, I've been a little quiet. I'm sure Instagram pictures can't really tell, but I had COVID extremely bad, and spent a better part of 9 months on, you know, in bed, sick. I mean, you know, wow. I don't even know, yeah. you know, the details of the pain and the agony and the flu-like symptoms and the inability to breathe and the high temps, you know. And I was in the RV and isolated because Ethan Jacob of Jacob's Ladder, he has his own health issues, and I just didn't want to expose him or Sharon. We rely on them heavily, and I didn't know how bad it was. And I'm really just now getting on the mend. So, truth be told, to answer your short question in a very lengthy manner, is tonight is really the first night that I've engaged the public, whether it's retailers or consumers, in 2021 because of my illness. I haven't been thinking clearly. I haven't been able to function clearly. But tonight really is kind of my getting back to it full time. And I'm in the RV. We're going to start doing some things, some events and visits and socials, and we're going to release that. But all that being said, I really have not got to sit down and pair and enjoy, you know, my bourbons or scotches or craft beers. I take pictures sometimes. That doesn't mean I'm always drinking those things. It's just things that I, the pairings that I've worked very hard over the years to test. But this is one that's going to be fun. Because I think it is another, like Cedrus for me, it's another very unique, very different blend profile for us than all the other cores that we've had up to this point. You know, something that took us our entire career in this industry to source the tobaccos, to blend them, and we'll get into that later as well. But it's special to us. And, you know, if you note that when we did the short press release in December, into December, we did not disclose the origin of tobaccos. I did not disclose my tasting notes. I did not disclose any blending notes as far as or pairing notes, either one, right? Because I really, for once, we wanted to have the media and our retailers and our consumers smoke the cigar and really test their palate and their knowledge of tobaccos and origin of tobaccos. And, you know, some people love Dominican, some people love Cuban, some people love Nicaraguan, some people love Honduran, some people love Costa Rican, Peruvian, whatever. But for once, we held that back. We held that information. And since we've done that, there wasn't a lot of pairing, you know, whiskey, beer, you know, whatever it may be. But we're going to get to that. We've got a lot of homework ahead. But it was just, I wanted everybody to have the experience, not have an experience I told them that they should have. I want them to have their own experience and share with us what this blend, what experience it's given to them.
Right. Yeah. Well, and I mean, kind of speaking to that, like with Southern Draw and the career and the business as it was, for some people, I mean, I think that Southern Draw is continually growing, and it's one of those brands that, like, if you haven't tried it, I highly recommend you to try it because it has such a unique flavor, but it's also got that flavor punch. There's some cigars out there that you light up and you'll be smoking through it, and it takes a while for that flavor to actually hit you. Southern Draw is, once you light that stick, it's with you, and you taste the essence of the tobacco, the character of the tobacco, which is something I've always appreciated about Southern Draw's brand. And with that, like, when you guys started Southern Draw, what brands did you launch with, and what did that look like in the beginning?
The beginning was the Kudzu Oscuro in the box pressed, of course, the Firethorn Rosado. And then within, it was planned, obviously, about 7 years in advance. We followed quickly with the value line, which was the quick draw in the Connecticut Habano and the Pennsylvania Broadleaf in the smaller ring or the thin ring gauge. So we kind of came out of the gate in 2014 with two core blends, kind of middle of the road, one medium, medium full, distinctly different, of course, and then focused on having a value line as a new brand. We wanted to be in that $5 to $6 range for people if they just wanted to try us. And, you know, consequently, the quick draw has become one of the more sought after, you know, quick smokes, you know, value price smokes, great blends in their own right.
Yeah. Okay. And I mean, and I think it's funny because the Kudzu, I love that blend. It's a great cigar. But oftentimes when you hear Southern Draw, it's synonymous most of the time with Rosa Sharon. And we actually, I'm going to pull up a comment here. We got Andy saying Rosa Sharon pairs well with coffee. It was one of the heavy hitting cigars when we originally opened. Everyone's, do you have the rose? Do you have the rose? So what brought about, what was the evolution of the Rosa Sharon?
Well, again, our plan was to release one core line per year. Okay. And to integrate that into, you know, production and packaging and sales, if you will. But quietly, I did not know, that in the beginning of Southern Draw, if Southern Draw would take, if we had a place in the industry, if it was going to be something more than a hobby with a lot of, homework behind it and investment. Mm. Right. But soon after, you know, 2014, 2015, Sharon started integrating, more of a role in the company, focusing on customer service and administrative in a finance, you know, in a financial capacity. But what happened that year in, you know, moving into 2015 and 2016 was, it was our 20th anniversary, and I had blended that cigar many years in advance. I wanted to have a blend that truly was her character, was her personality, and was something that I felt like, much like the Rose of Sharon from a biblical standpoint, is a flower and a plant that not only looks pretty, but it's very durable. It can be planted anywhere. It'll thrive anywhere. And she's proven over now 25, you know, 26 years together that her versatility and her flexibility was a lot about that blend, right? And yeah. I think the only way to tell the story of her personality and her influences on my life is to go all out. And I think we got told by some pretty significant people in the industry, don't put pink on your band. Well, you know, Eric, here's the thing. The Rose of Sharon that grows in our yard and always has is her Rose of Sharon. And we took those petals, you know, from the rose, and we took those to cigar rings, and we were able to create the Pantone that today, is draped across every Rose of Sharon. That is a Rose of Sharon pink is what it is. So the color had everything to do with it. The beauty of that cigar had a lot, and you mentioned it 5 minutes ago that everything has a punch. Well, so does a rose. You know, if you see a nice, you know, flower and or nice rose, you reach down to pick it up and you just try to break it off and take it in and put it in a votive, you might get a thorn, right? So it does have a pretty good, pretty strong Piloto Cubano Ligero in it. And it's something that we've continued as the Rose of Sharon blend evolves. I find myself, you know, somebody mentioned coffee a moment ago. I bet today alone, I've probably had 6 different Rose of Sharon's today. There's never a day that goes by that I don't enjoy that cigar. One, whether I'm with Sharon or without Sharon, which I'm without right now, it's an honor of her. She's made this possible. Her touch on the customer service and support and the charities that we do brought that cigar to the market at the right time. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Now, think about this. We started with the Firethorn and the Kudzu. And in the same year, we dropped the Rose of Sharon on the left side of the spectrum. But because we had missed the trade show due to the FDA deeming regs coming down that year, we missed a year at the trade show, and we stayed in the factory, and we worked on producing every blend I had in the book and every size and every package option. And we had to assume the worst, right, which is we needed to have everything by that August cutoff, if everybody remembers back that far.
Right, right.
So, hey, listener, you miss a year. The following year, you have the previous year's release, which was the Rose of Sharon. But we got to bookend that with the Jacob's Ladder.
And
again, Ethan Jacob is our son. We've got some things, you know, to very similar story about his personality, his strength and his boldness, and that flavor profile. It really is about being bold but approachable. It's about having enough power to really satisfy full body, full flavored smokers, but also to have that through the fermentation, have that subtle sweetness and that ability to enjoy that cigar in different sizes where it's not just overpowering you all the time. And again, internally, I call the Rose of Sharon and the Jacob's Ladder the heart and soul of the business, because truly Sharon is the heart of Southern Draw, and Ethan is the soul. He is the future of Southern Draw. And, you know, it was tough not to lead with my Trump card, right? But the yeah. Firethorn and the Kudzu has done well. It's consistent for us. I enjoy those blends. They were my first blends ever. But to hold back for 2 years instead of one, to wait to bring the Rose and the Jacobs to market,
yeah.
it took a lot of patience. Right. But I wouldn't have it any other way, right? I mean, look at it. It's to this day, we cannot make enough of those cigars and those particular mm-hmm. blends. They do carry the brand to a lot of places.
Yeah. Well, and the thing that's funny about the Rose or even the Jacobs Ladder, I've had this a lot recently, is, I mean, as we expand as a shop and we're bringing in new blends and such, I've had multiple times people in the middle of smoking a Jacobs Ladder, whether it's the Brimstone or the first, and they'll turn to me and be like, what is this? This is really good. And it's very distinctive. And it's one of the best interpretations I feel like I've smoked of Pennsylvanian broadleaf. Pennsylvanian broadleaf has that, like, that rustic quality about it, that strength. But as you say, there's a lot of that sweetness in that Jacob's Ladder as well. And it's just, it complements yeah. it very well.
Yeah, good point, and I appreciate it. You know, for me, it's a small industry, and there were people that came before me that really were experts and are experts in either the growing, the processing, or the utilization and blending of Connecticut broadleaf. To me, mm-hmm. that market was already owned by Roma Craft and by Foundation, which came after us. Nick is a younger company, but his expertise was there and it was relevant.
Yeah.
And I was aware of that. And then, you know, subsequently, of course, Steve Saka and Dunbarton Tobacco and Trust. But there's some people that did tremendous things with Connecticut broadleaf. And I felt to me that the market was cornered, and I wouldn't even try or attempt at this point to compete with something that I think they've all done a phenomenal job on. And they have a lot of history in that. But truth be told, I fell in love with Pennsylvania broadleaf. I fell in love with it because the way it was processed in multiple fermentation stages and that subtle sweetness that I thought would be a magic card, you know, a little play for us to really bring some power. But yeah. to disguise that power was something that I didn't think Connecticut broadleaf could do. It just, you know, to each their own, of course. But to me, I was very passionate about using the broadleaf. We use it in two different blends, of course, two different varietals of Lancaster County mm-hmm. broadleaf, but the Jacobs Ladder, and then, of course, the quick draw, aforementioned quick draw Pennsylvania. But I love the flavor profile. I love the variations in these blends. Both the Rose and the Jacobs get a lot of variations. They're very popular.
Yeah.
Sometimes we do double wrapper, double binder, triple Lajero. We've done a triple Maduro triple Lajero in the Brimstone. I mean, we're really having fun. I think keeping the core line, core blends, and core sizes intact, they sell well, but having fun every year with something new, something fresh between those two lines.
Mm-hmm. Well, and when asked, what is the main distinction between Jacob's Ladder and Jacob's Ladder Brimstone? What do those two blends look like? What's distinctive about them?
Well, first of all, the Brimstone is has multiple broadleaf wrappers, right? It's not just a single wrapper. So you're going to replace the binder. It's going to be a little more fuller bodied. But the other distinct difference is in all of the Brimstones, less Un Presidente, the Grand Corona, because that one, it was something unique I wanted to do, and I missed everything because of COVID, so we kind of snuck it out the door. But we also replaced the Lajeros in the Jacob's Ladder, and we used two Esteli Lajeros in the Brimstone. Instead of having one that has got a lot of power, one that has a lot of aroma, and one that has a lot of very distinct flavor. But mm-hmm. But to me, the Brimstone, especially the 656, we released a 558 as well, the Oblivion, which is a triple Maduro, triple Lajero. So we've got some variations on that. But as my wife says, it's too strong for her. But she can go back to the original Jacob's Ladder Lancero, and she can enjoy that any day of the week. And I think it's just kind to, you still get to enjoy the broadleaf.
Right.
It's a great interpretation of it. And you don't have that power that you got to contend with. And I tell people all the time, you know, you gotta eat a little protein for most of those Jacob's Ladder. Have something
yes.
in your stomach,
yeah.
If you really want to enjoy it. But you know, the Rose of Sharon, I can smoke the Rose right after a Jacob's Ladder, and I'll enjoy it thoroughly, just like I started the day with it. It has its own flavor and its own cleansing principles, I think. And I really do go up and down throughout the day. I don't build throughout the day or go down throughout the day. I go with the mood. Who am I thinking about? You know, what projects am I working on? How much homework do I need to do on? We're changing blends, or we're changing projects, we're changing vitolas, we're changing formats. Maybe we're moving from round to box press. So I'm smoking today. I smoked one blend that we've talked about today in four or five different formats for a new release that's coming out in 2021. But they're distinctly different, but they're all very powerful.
Right. Right. Well, and I mean, I think a lot of the time when you hear in the industry, you hear a lot thrown around, not your grandfather's Connecticut. The thing that I like and enjoy about the Rose of Sharon, or even more so about the Lonsdale, the Desert Rose, that cigar is just phenomenal, is that it's not your grandfather's Connecticut, not so much in the sense of power, but in flavor. I feel like there's a lot of Connecticuts on the market that I've smoked in the past that are more airy, they're more light, they're more technically smooth, but they don't have that like flavor satisfaction, I suppose, that both of the roses have. And the Rose of Sharon is an anybody cigar. It's approachable to any. And even for myself, or who smokes medium plus the full body and strength, it's one of those cigars I thoroughly enjoy and can enjoy, whether it's in the late evening, beginning of the day, because of that flavor punch. And it's just that complexity. My hat's off to you to creating a Connecticut with that complexity.
Well, again, thank you, Eric. You know, this all goes back to a lot of very solid partners, whether it's in the farms or the factories in the processing side. I mean, think about little company, a couple of gringos walk in the door, and I have this 15-year plan and strategy, and I throw it on the table, and I get the eyes rolled, and I get laughed at, because a lot of people have come and gone, and not everybody's as blessed as we are to have survived and even grown. I mean, we had the FDA year could have killed us, right?
Right.
I mean, consequently, we probably should have packed our tent up, really. But we fought through it, and we try to support those that support us. But, you know, the COVID year could have killed us. I mean, March 1st, we never got to see another customer for the year. We live on the road. We live for visits. We live for events. And it forced us to do things differently, just like it did a lot of people in the industry. But it broke my spirit, because I think our place is with other people. We're in this industry to be together with other people in fellowship. And I think taking that away, Zooms were fun, and, you know, whereby's were fun, and, you know, Instagram and Facebook Live were fun, but we're not handshake people. We're hug people, you know, and it really broke us. And now, once COVID kind of everything opened up, then I got COVID. And then it kind of crushed us again. So, you know, you rely back on these blends and these partnerships, and you realize that you don't have to do it all yourself. The people in Nicaragua have picked up the pieces that I left in my absence, and they have executed everything, because we forecast way out. But, you know, a few hiccups here or there, but that's the entire industry, right? Transportation was a big one. But I tell you what, they picked up the pieces, and everything that I'm smoking that I had planned to release this year it's going to be released later, because I didn't go to the trade show for my own health reasons. But we're still going to, we released three great Manzanitas, and we're going to release a couple more things this year that I think will get a lot of people's attention. But, you know, we're going to live by those core blends that we put into the market and those core sizes. Right. And we're going to have fun with all these other projects. And the only way that happens is retailers reach out to us and said, hey, we know you can't make this and put it on the market, but can you make it for us if we commit to X number of boxes or bundles or cigars? And once we have a little a first take on this, you know, once we get to sell through it, maybe we build a market for you. So we're learning to barter a little bit right now. Everybody's coming and going, hey, let's do this together. And if it takes off, obviously we own our own rights. But those partnerships, those collaborations, I think would have never happened in the past if it wasn't for COVID and us all trying to find a new way to do business,
right,
to bring something to market and to survive.
Yeah. Well, and I remember when the Lonsdale Rose of Sharon Desert Rose Lonsdale was released, and I had placed an order with Sharon, and Sharon was like, well, I'll tell you what, I'll send you a small 5-pack of samples. Let me know what you think. And I was like, well, I'm sure it's good. Send me a box and I'll smoke the samples. Well, I remember smoking one of those, getting her on the phone and telling her, I think I made a huge mistake. And she was like, wait, what's wrong? And I was like, I sure ordered three or four boxes, not one. It's not going to be enough. And it's really where Southern Draw shines is it's your blends. And it's the cigars speak for themselves.
Well, again, we're honored. We appreciate the kind words. That Lonsdale, again, not only because I love the size, I love the profile, but it's the cigar I've smoked the most in the last 18 months, hands down. I don't think anything else comes close. And the market supported us so well. And I got to give a shout out to the cigar package design folks there in Miami, because it was right before COVID started where we got that done. But that was the first time we ever collaborated on a box design together with the designer and the factory, and said, we want something that we can focus on for small ring gauge in the future that stand out. Because as you can imagine, you own a shop. You buy Lanceros or Lonsdales, they don't fit. I mean, it's rare that you see a package that goes, yeah, his head is too big for his body. You know what I mean? It just it doesn't fit my eye. And I think the functionality that we were looking for is present. I think it's a beautiful box. It's a well-executed box, and it's a box design that's going to allow us to enjoy some smaller ring gauge. And you notice in that one, we went down to 12 cigars for a reason, because roses come in dozens, right? But I think it's worked well for us because the price point has become affordable for a lot of consumers to buy the 12 count box versus a 20 count box. So it was a good, kind of beta test for us on a 12 count box, a new design and a new size. But we've sold tremendously well through that cigar in the last, you know, in the last year since we released it.
Yeah. We got actually a comment by Jason saying Jacob's Ladder was one of the first full bodied cigars when getting back into cigars. And it's funny is that the first cigar this gentleman purchased from my shop was a Rosa Sharon. He loved it. He wanted to go to the Jacob's Ladder, and I had reservations. I was like, you know, you're more on the lighter side. And I remember seeing a picture he posted of it, and I was like, I don't know if this is a good or bad review. And he absolutely loved it. Jacob's Ladder is one of the staples of his repertoire.
You know, I like to hear it. It is rare that you can go to the ends of the spectrum that those two cigars represent and have a palate that can enjoy both of those. I'm one of those people. I tell you what, it took me years to come back to smoking anything that appears to be mild, you know, a Connecticut shade or a shade wrapper. And since then, there's a few, you know, I've been smoking Roma Craft and Temperance for some time. They make another blend that I prefer, but I like that. AJ Fernandez has done some great things. Of course, I smoke the New World Connecticut almost loyally, but originally it was the San Latano Oval Connecticut that really showed me, as a guy that smokes tremendous amounts of cigars, that Connecticut does not have to be boring. And I'm not saying there's not a place and time, because it sells a tremendous a lot. Some people like mild, creamy, light, you know, low power. Mm-hmm. I mean, hey, I get it. I call it, it's like a cruiser, you know, you get to go downhill on that, but, on the bike, you don't have to pedal. I'm not one of those guys, but the Rosa Sharon and I'll tell you this, if you've smoked the Perfecto, it's in the round format, until the Desert Rose Lonsdale, we haven't had a round format cigar, right? It's a different cigar. It's a totally different smoking cigar. But the soft box press on the Rosa Sharon, the influence on that, when I smoked the round box press and semi box pressed, was really gave me that experience that original San Latano Oval box press did for me, where I really thoroughly enjoyed that Connecticut blend. So it's just worked well for that particular blend. And of course, the round format has worked in the Lonsdale and the Perfecto, but they're different blends.
Yeah, definitely. We got a gentleman on Facebook saying his name is Gotug Uktug. Awesome place. I learned a lot from you guys. And that's really what we want to accomplish, is that education. We've talked about the Rosa Sharon. We've talked about Jacob's Ladder. There's a name I see that's missing here, and that's the Robert. Where's the Robert cigar?
Well, I appreciate the question. I got to tell you, you know, to be self-aware, you know, when this brand started, I didn't know it would be the whole family. I wasn't sure. And our family is much larger than most people know that have invested time, money, and resources into Southern Draw to allow us to grow. But it's about influences. It's about specific influences, whether it's a person, a place, or an experience, right? And for me, I am who I am because of the people that have surrounded me over, you know, my adult life and made concessions on my behalf and gave guidance when I needed it and, you know, were harsh when they needed to be, were loving when they needed to be. And there'll never be a Robert Cigar. I'm not that important to myself. I'm not that impressive. The message is far more important than the name on a cigar or a blend. And I am not knocking anybody that puts their own name on it. Hey, to each right. his own or her own, right?
Right.
But for us, this brand is about the celebration of incredible influences in my life that made me who I am and allowed me to be where I'm at today. And I tell you what, I wouldn't change it. The 15-year plan is sound. You know, we hope that we can survive because we got so many more people to thank. And I tell you what, if you're in the cigar business and you're trying to grow and you didn't start with a lot of money, you don't have a lot of money. I can promise you. You kind of just, you know, you're kind of, you know, hand to mouth, right? You really got to plan this out. So if we're blessed enough to be here for the long term, expect more stories and more people. And you know, the Cedrus, the Hogan, when it came out, right? I mean, very important. The Kudzu and Firethorn are really homages to military throughout our family's experience and service and locations of service. There's a backstory to everything. That has always got to stay front and center for us. And I get it. You know, I'm sure Sharon and Ethan would love to have a cigar with my name on it as well, but that's not their role. Their role is not to blend and come up with very clever marketing. But sorry, I'm trying to get a update from happening here on my computer. I'm anxious to sell, to share more stories about more people and more influences through very specific blends that capture that character and who they are and what they eat and what they drink and how they do it. I mean, here's the thing. If your customers got to meet Sharon or Ethan or the Hogans, if you got to meet the people that we named the 300 hands for that we've got to know and their contributions to the community and their challenges, if you get to know these people and their personality and their character, you'll get it. You'll get it when you smoke the cigar, when you look at the cigar, when you touch the cigar, the blend, the Cedrus and its savory notes. And it really is about who these people are, where they come from, where they've been, and what they've done for their fellow man more than themselves. This is about being selfless, and that's what these people are.
Yeah. So in that side of the creating new blends, telling more stories, where does the concept of Manzanita come from? Where does that name and where were you drawing from?
Well, again, it was a little detour, if you will, if you really think about it. But we wanted to do a couple of things. Courtney Taylor has been with us and our family for over 20 years in a financial advisory accounting role, CPA by nature. It started when we worked in the public company sector. I used to be a public company, you know, technology company CEO. He was our CFO. But when we left the public sector, he came along with us and he's really had the oversight and guidance into our company and our accounting and our taxes and helping us grow, you know, really focusing on our margins, focusing on make sure we're categorizing everything that we do, marketing and promotional. All these things may sound easy, but they're not easy if your head's down and you're running. The thing about Courtney is over the years, we lived in Utah together when we had, you know, our interest in the public companies, and he's a big University of Utah fan. He's a big supporter through the Crimson Club to their athletic programs, educational scholarships. You know, our kids were able to grow and to go to University of Utah. We do events there each year with Southern Draw. where we take shop staff and customers that go to the events. We do a raffle, and they get to go to enjoy tailgating and meeting the team and go to the games, and they get to do a lot of great things. But Courtney's not one to be in the public eye. If you've gone to the trade show, you've seen him. If you've gone to some of the large, large events, he's been there. But I really wanted to capture a few things here. And I wanted to do it with the mindset that Manzanita has a very serious or very important role in the culture. University of Utah Utes, that's a reference to Native Americans. And, of course, the Ute tribes are throughout the Southwest and the Pacific Northwest and the Rockies in the United States. And I think this is the most important thing, is Manzanita has been used as a reference to Ute tobacco. And it's also been used as an additive to tobacco to enjoy for ceremonial reasons, for medicinal reasons, making deals, you know, for literally closing transactions, for spiritual reasons. And, you know, in our research over the last 10 years, what we found is we give a lot of credence to a lot of folks sometimes, but, you know, our Native American tribes in North America have been smoking tobacco for over 4,000 years. 4,000 years. So I wanted to tie something. The Manzanita tree is obviously is something. If you've seen it, it's bright red. It's shiny.
Right.
It is absolutely gorgeous. It's great for ornamental reasons. It's great for, you know, I've seen bowls and spoons and all kinds of things carved. Obviously, the Native tribes have used it in a variety of ways. But we wanted to pay homage to the history of tobacco and the fact that Courtney was so well tied to the University of Utah. You'll notice that even the band colors correspond to the colors of the University of Utah and the University of Utah Utes. These are the specific Pantone colors from that university. And we just wanted to say thank you. And he's a humble guy, and I don't think he would let us do it just for him. So tying the Native American, trying to, you know, history and uses. Here's the thing. We could argue with the FDA all day, and they could tell us how bad it is. It should be taxed this way, and we should have all these restrictions and oversight. But here's the reality. I use this tobacco or this cigar today the same exact way our Native ancestors have been using it for 4,000 years. I use it for spiritual reasons. I use it for medicinal reasons. I use it when I'm mourning. I use it when I'm celebrating. I use it when I close deals. It has all of these properties. And I'll tell you what, something that's gone on for 4,000 years like this needs to be acknowledged. Now, that being said, I was cautioned when I talked to Courtney and I talked to several of the tribal members. They said, keep in mind that tobacco use in amongst Native Americans is a problem. Our youth have a problem with the use use of tobacco. So we need to be very distinct in the difference between traditional tobacco and commercial tobacco. Traditional tobacco was natural, air-cured tobacco, and at times mixed with Manzanita and things like sage for smudging, which is a disinfectant. It wasn't just done for ceremonial reasons. You got to really learn why we did it. So what we did is we partnered together again with Cigar Package Design on the beautiful, you know, black box that sport these same colors. And we partnered with the Native American, man, I told you I got the COVID brain.
No worries.
Yeah, it's the First Nations Development Institute, because they were the ones that reached out to us and said, listen, we need to push the prohibition of commercial tobaccos among our tribal members, but we need to educate and inform our youth about the traditional uses of tobacco, which is something that you do. And I said, well, what can we do in this mission to help? And, you know, we looked at a couple of different charity options and programs they had. And what we found is they're going back to teach the young generation of the natives how to grow sustainable food, eat healthy, live from the land, and try to do things in a very traditional manner, which was also a healthy manner. Less fast food, commercial alcohol, tobacco, those kind of things. So we can enjoy a premium cigar that has great heritage, great cultural significance, and at the same time, Southern Draw, you as our retail partner, and the customers that buy it are all contributing a good portion of every sale to the First Nations Development Institute. And not only that, but the gentleman that's in charge at the Institute of our particular program is a great cigar lover, and we love to share it. So he was one of the first people to get the Manzanita as well. But it's a great backstory. Thank you to Courtney. Yeah. We honor his support of the University of Utah and the Ute tribe in general, and all of our Native American culture that have used this tobacco the same way we do. And we want to preserve that heritage. We want to educate people in that. We want to make sure that people know there's a difference between commercial tobacco and this traditional tobacco.
Right.
And if we do it all together, we'll beat the FDA. We'll all continue to grow our family-owned businesses. And in the end, we're still doing something very charitable for the people that have given us this influence. Long story. But
no, definitely. Well, we actually have Ian Thompson saying, how do you use it medicinally? And I mean, I think that's more of a question geared towards you, like how you use it medicinally.
It's a great question. I think the definition of medicinal is different for everyone. I don't partake of any drugs. I don't take aspirins. I don't have any prescriptions from any doctors. I don't go to doctors. We have always been, since Sharon's been around, for the most part, we've been a naturopath. I don't know if I've been to a doctor in over 20 years, even with COVID, vitamin C and vitamins. But for me, here's the thing. I've been under a lot of stress. I've had a lot of injuries, whether it was military, how I grew up, the abuse that I took, whatever it may be, without going into it.
Right.
And I have always been able to rely on having a cigar. Sometimes it's by myself, sometimes it's with you good folks. So my definition of medicinal is the same as the natives, which is, this is cleansing to me. This is relaxing to me. This allows my blood pressure to be suppressed. This allows me to think.
Yeah.
And some people need to take a whole slew of drugs to do that. So when I say medicinal, I don't mean it's prescribed. It's self-prescribed, but it has allowed me to avoid all of these other things that I don't want to put in my body. And to be as natural as possible. And I think if you look at my wife the same way, she doesn't go to doctors. She doesn't take drugs. I mean, we're not saying it's right or wrong, but for us, it's right.
Right.
If you want to reduce stress and you want to avoid putting other things in your body, you got to find a solution. And for us, premium cigars, notwithstanding the art and the beautiful people that need food, clothing, shelter, education, and opportunity that support us all, the medicine is right here in this tightly rolled bundle of tobacco that allows us to survive and allows us to grow and allows us to think and allows us to sleep. It just allows us to do a lot of things. And Centrum Junior can do it.
Yeah. Well, and Giovanni Flores says, what are your favorite recreational activities to incorporate with smoking cigars? Are you one who sits down and relaxes, or are you doing things while you're smoking, or both?
Well, Giovanni, it's a great question. And if you get to know me, you'll know this. There is only one single recreational activity in the world that I do. And I'm not good at it, but I only do one thing. The rest is all work. Fly fishing. I enjoy fly fishing.
Okay.
While I'm smoking. I have quite a talent for smoking and fishing without burning my line. I've learned to do that. You know, this world is amazing. I've been honored to go or blessed to go and visit and travel through all 50 states, all of our territories. I've been to 66 countries, and I've smoked in all of them. But what is left for me in this world outside of what we do with this family business is I want to explore the rivers of the world more thoroughly, because I find great peace, much like with cigars. There's a perfect symbiotic relationship there between me, moving water, a fly rod, and a cigar in my hand. I have got no worries in the world, and I pray that my cell phone does not work while I do it.
Nice. Yeah. Well, and talking about kind of the the curing in tobacco and the creation of it. Andy's wondering, can you market, and I kind of have heard this story before, but can you market it as organic? Saying it's organic is one thing. Can you market it, though?
Well, the short answer is I absolutely do not think we can. I think there are certain regulations in North America, FDA, and otherwise that requires things like fumigation, that requires things like pesticides and things like that because of the possibility of importing outside insects and funguses and things like that. So I don't know anybody that could market it as organic. Of course, I don't have their money and don't have their legal teams, but I think we're prohibited from using that term. But I can say this, most of us now do everything we can within the realm of possibility to do just that, which is grow this naturally, prime this naturally, dry this naturally, separate this naturally, ferment this with only heat, moisture, and pressure, nothing added, and allow us to roll that naturally. And then, of course, we get to enjoy it. So there is no shortcuts going on. I'm not saying there's none anywhere. I'm just saying for the most part, we've been to a lot of factories. We've seen most of them, and they're from the farm to the field. To the production floor, we've seen a lot of steps being made to really keep this in its truest form, which is its natural form of air cured, you know, tobacco.
Yeah. Well, and kind of in that same vein, I mean, going to different factories and trying different blends and different creators and such. What was the meeting between you and AJ? Like, how did that come about, your business partnership?
Sometimes you gotta not go into detail, and I'm usually not one for that. But you know, we were fans of AJ, the people that I spent time with and smoked cigars with. In those days, we were all healthy enough that we played golf and we worked hard and we played hard and we fished. We did a lot of things, but we always found ourselves smoking AJ's and early blends.
Okay.
But we looked in the Dominican and Nicaragua primarily. We were quite certain, or I was quite certain that I wanted to, if it ever came to fruition, I wanted to be in Nicaragua. And we were nobodies, right? And maybe we're nobodies today, and that's okay. It's not about measuring success or our position in this industry. But when we went there, I can assure you nobody had ever heard of us. but we had a plan, and we had families that committed, and we felt like we had some pretty good initial blends and market and branding strategies. And most importantly, we knew within ourselves that we were committed 100%. We're not wealthy. We're not writing a check going, make us some great cigars, charge us as little as possible. We're going to do it. So you want to know how we did a relationship. We knew we were using expensive tobaccos. We knew that our process was something we wanted to be hands-on. We knew that it was going to cost more than a small branch should spend on tobaccos. And I know we hear it all the time. Tobacco only costs this, only costs that. Well, listen, maybe if you live in Nicaragua or live in the DR and you have better source than I do when you started, great. But it's not the truth for us. It was expensive. It was difficult to source what we wanted to accomplish the original initial blends. And to have a long-term strategy around that was tough, but we did it. We took our time to have that. And meeting with AJ, and quite honestly, he revealed some things about the source and origin of the tobacco, the process of the tobacco, in order to do two things. We wanted to be consistent, and we wanted to be sustainable. And he helped us see the light into the factors that allow us to be consistent and sustainable. Those are decisions you have to make as a brand owner. But most importantly, he didn't shut the door. As we talked about problems that we had early on, we weren't partners yet. He helped us through that. And over time, as my wife and I got to know him, it was an aha moment if he would be interested in doing business with us. And honestly, when we started, he was already growing, but I mean, he was obviously a lot smaller than he is now. But he's who we wanted to work with. But we were humble enough to realize that we didn't deserve to work with him and his family. Now, that being said, he took us in. He's done everything that we've asked. He's been through us through our growing pains. And ultimately, there's times I think that he does things for us that take away from his own brand and his own efforts, right? I know he's done that for us to help us sustain and to grow and to, you know, I don't dot every I and cross every T sometimes. I miss things in production forecasts and packaging, and, you know, he'll make me aware of it. But the partnership started by just trusting one another. We had both been, we've had both experienced some mistrust and lost money and lost opportunity by doing business with people. And it was tough. It was tough, I think, for both of us to shake hands and go, this is what we're going to do. And we just do our best, and we hope we make him proud with what we do and how we do it. You know, I wish he would take more credit for his contributions and his team's contributions. But listen, he's busy. I mean, he's a busy guy, right?
Yeah.
But, you know, we just laid it on the table. This is our long-term plan. This is our short-term strategy. And we'd like to do it here. And he said, let's do it. But just promise me that if we do something well here, you're not going to get too big and go somewhere else and take away everything that we worked together for. And we've not done that. We've been very loyal, and he's been loyal as well.
Definitely. Definitely. And no, and it's awesome. And anyone who smoked AJ stuff knows the quality that comes from AJ. And so it's just, it's a really cool thing to see Southern Draw's partnership with AJ and have your own blending and your own flavors and such that are produced by his factory. It's just awesome. I'm going to pull up real quick for those watching the sampler pack that we're offering. This is a killer sampler pack. You have both Rosa Sharons. That is the Desert Rose Lonsdale and the Rosa Sharon Toro. Phenomenal Connecticuts. It's got that flavor that is unlike any other Connecticut I've had. I'm smoking the Manzanita right now, which has included the newest Southern Draw release and then both Jacob's Ladder. If you guys want to pick up the sampler pack, make sure you click on the link in this video. That will direct you to our website. That is where you can pick up your Southern Draw cigars. As we kind of come to the end here, Robert, if you don't mind, I have a few questions I normally ask a lot of the manufacturers, a lot of the guests that we have on the show, just to hear their take on it. One of which is, if you have an ideal like environment or situation to enjoy a cigar, like your ideal place to be, whether it's with music, with friends or people, what does that look like?
it's not an easy short answer. I mean, obviously we love enjoying cigars at shops and doing events and all those things, but you know, honestly, to sit down one-on-one is far more productive. It allows you to explore and to get to know even better. And as my wife says, the drive-by at an event is very difficult on everybody because everybody wants a few minutes, but a few minutes is never enough. So I actually enjoy the one-on-one aspect, which you know, there's times I'll go into a shop that doesn't carry Southern Draw, and I intentionally go there with no Southern Draw logo and no cigars because I want to have a cigar with somebody. And I don't want to be preaching Southern Draw. So there's times, and I did it the other day just to test my own health and things. But I went into a shop. I bought a New World, AJ Fernandez, and I bought the other gentleman in Upman, Connecticut. He liked Connecticut. But I had a very lengthy two-hour discussion with someone that I would have not had if I was at my own event or a shop that carries Southern Draw. I was there incognito, if you will. And it was quite rewarding. So actually, I prefer, it really doesn't matter what walk of life or, you know, level of smoking experience that these people, that anybody has. I like meeting people for the first time and having a cigar together because I think it's the finest way to have a conversation and really kind of just, you know, just learn something. I mean, it's been said many times, I'll be the thousandth person to say it. There's not a person in the world that you can't learn something from. And to sit down with a cigar and a conversation, you have that opportunity at that moment.
Yeah. Okay. Definitely. And on a average given day basis, how many cigars do you suppose you smoke on a daily basis?
Hey, don't tell me. If my wife is watching this, I'm going to be in trouble. Keep in mind that I smoke for enjoyment. I do smoke other people's blends. Obviously, I smoke ours to check consistency on what's in the marketplace. Right. But we have a lot of projects, and if I don't give the thumbs up, those projects aren't going out. So I smoke about 12 cigars a day on average.
Oh wow!
full?
COVID, I pulled back on that a little bit because I didn't have the stamina. I didn't have the palate. It's just coming back. Luckily, a lot of the blend work was done years ago, so that's good. Okay. But now I'm getting to enjoy them again. But 10 to 12 cigars is kind of an average day, assuming that I'm up for 18 hours.
Yeah. And yeah. Is that like smoking those cigars full through or like halfway through? Or
I don't leave any cigar laying around. It doesn't happen. The rapture could come, and I'm going to finish my cigar. I'll tell you that. You can write that down, put it on a T-shirt. The good Lord himself will not stop me. I just, listen, a lot, maybe there are cigars made that I think the first third is great, or maybe halfway you get to the band, you kind of put it down. And maybe some are made with tobaccos and at a price point where that's okay. But I cannot assume that any of our customers is going to put it down after the first third, the first half. I have to assume that they're going to smoke it to the nub, right? If that's the case, our homework requires us to let that experience happen for ourselves before we expect anybody else to adopt that, right? I mean, I really enjoy it. And I don't care if I, and I mentioned people like Skip Martin and Eric Espinosa. I should have mentioned him earlier because I do smoke a lot of the Laranja still when I can find it. And even Saka and Nick Malilo, mostly what he makes together with AJ. But I mentioned them because in my mind, they've all taught me more one-on-one, not just about cigars or tobacco, but about how small brands have to have their own goals and their own strategy, because one size does not fit all. Mm-hmm. It doesn't fit all, right?
Right.
Roma has their own. Malilo has his own. Saka has his own. Take over the world, right? Eric has been, you know, just been at it for so long. So at the end of the day, you can learn a lot from each one of them. But, you know, smoking 10 to 12 cigars sometimes mean I've got to go in and, or I mean, I'll tell you, one of my favorite dudes is Island Jim. You know, I went in the other day and I bought a Sumatra and a Maduro leaf, because another guy had never even seen him in his life. It was just a guy standing there admiring him. And I got to go into the shop and I found a box of Island Gems, which were back order and they didn't have any, but they had a box sitting down there and I was able to open them up, put them on the shelf and say, Jim, look, we got them back in stock. But man, there's just some cool cats that you just like to smoke their cigars and you appreciate their art too. And they do it differently. And the whole beauty of it is we all do the same thing, but hopefully we all do it just a little bit differently.
Right. Well, and actually Ian Thompson on Facebook is asking if you can find Southern Draw cigars in San Diego or only online. We have them in shop and online right now. We got the killer sampler pack, but Robert, you probably know that more than I, as far as if there's any local brick and mortars in San Diego that might carry them.
There are, and it might be better just to direct message me on Instagram, SD Cigars, or Facebook, because sometimes we run into problems by not naming every retailer and it's not a fair shake. But I'll tell you who typically has the most there is Churchill's in Old Town. They typically do. We're going through a little transition in California, which Eric, you probably didn't even know that yet, but it'll be announced in the next couple of days. We'll have some representation changes and a little more aggressive strategy out there. And then, of course, you know, San Diego was home for me for a long time. I was at Qualcomm for a long time, and I'm looking forward to getting my health back and getting back out west. And it'll be next year. I mean, there's no question. This year, the way things are working out, I'm going to have to work the east because of where my health was when I decided only in the last few days to do it. And in the RV, I'm doing that so I can kind of take care of myself instead of flying and driving in hotels every day. I don't have that ability back yet, but we want to do the same next year out west. So we're going to focus on the Mountain West and the West Coast next year, and you know, visit as much as we can. And the beauty of the bandwagon is we don't have to go home. You know, I mean, when we pull in, we're there for a while.
Nice. Well, and then that kind of leads into one of the final questions of I know that you, for personal reasons and such, were unable to attend PCA or TPE. Do you see that as a reality for 2022?
Short answer, yes. Here's the thing. We will never, ever, ever pass on an opportunity to spend time with our retailers and the media or to support the industry associations, no matter what's negative said or positive said about it, how big or how little, we will always have a presence if it wasn't for health related. And of course, we missed it once one other time because, again, I'll tell you this, if we hadn't missed it in 2015, when the FDA regs came down, we would have been out of business. There's no question about it. So, you know, it was unfortunate, but it truly was my own health, you know, and when you're not healthy, you can't plan. And if you can't plan, you can't execute. And if you can't execute, you're going to embarrass your brand and your family. And I couldn't do that to anybody. So we hated to miss it, but it's not something that we anticipate doing anymore. I would think that in the future, if I'm not able for, and I don't recover fully, then the family will still make it. And the family probably could have done as good or a better job anyway. But I wouldn't put that stress and that pressure of a trade show of setting up and manning on somebody else if I'm not willing to put it on my own shoulders, right? So, but we've got some things coming down, the announcements in the next, you know, 30, 60 days. We've got some help coming in a big way on behalf of the family that's going to help us pay more attention to our retail partners, better on customer service, and we're going to have another body that's really going to allow Sharon and I to optimize what we do on a daily basis instead of trying to be Atlas and put it all on our own shoulders. We got some help.
Okay. Yeah. Well, and I know that you've hinted towards some of the things coming down the pipeline for the rest of the year. Is there any info on any new blends or new sizes or things that you can give, or is that still restricted info?
Let me think. Yeah, it's restricted. I had to think it through because, you know, here's the thing. We do have a couple of retail exclusives coming out that will be, I'm sure some of those will be in the wholesale market too. There's no question about it. But I get to bring out new blends that I couldn't have put out on my own. That's the beauty of these projects, you know, is I can't put every blend of every size that I want to because we can't afford to do it. But partners, when retailers come in and do it, they let us really enjoy it. And then if it's successful, you know, some of these Cigar of the Month clubs, what's going on with those is those are new blends. Those are blends that I've had in the book that we're given a shot. And if the feedback is strong enough, then we kind of know where to put them in the box of crayons. Right.
Yeah. So,
and we've got something coming in September. I can't say yet because it's a true surprise, but it's going to be unique. Actually, we have something in October coming out. So actually this fall, we got about four releases, but for us as a core offering, the Manzanita was our year. I mean, we wanted to put it out in Robusto Toro Gordo boxes and bundles. You know, some of the retailers have taken those bundles and made them into samplers, which is great. But it has been a blessing. It's been well received. It's a high margin product for the retail partners. It's a very expensive cigar for us to make. It's not inexpensive tobacco by any means. Mm-hmm. It may not be something that everybody that smokes cigars wants to spend their money on because they can buy the big brands and when they get in that price point. But I would much rather have the Manzanita on the price for the on the market for the fair price that we have than not bring it out at all. And keep in mind, the charity aspect was a must. And when you put a cigar in a 10 count box, it's going to cost a little bit more too. So, but that box is the perfect frame for this cigar. The Manzanita name, that shiny red hybrid Habano wrapper, it is spot on for what it was meant to be. The team did a great job. Cigar package design, Esteli Box Factory, cigar rings, AJ Fernandez and Southern Draw. We did pretty good too, but I tell you what, I couldn't be more proud of the body of work that we did in a COVID year.
Yeah.
And pulled this thing off, you know?
Definitely. Definitely. Well, kind of, and alluding to those membership releases, actually in a week, maybe a week, week and a half, we're actually getting the LCA release through Privada Cigar Club through you guys, the Lady Killer Maduro, which we're really excited about.
You know, I won't say too much because Brian hasn't even sent me anything to post yet. And I know the release date's next week. That was a 2-year project, and we'll get into the details because I'm sure he's probably saving some of that. But I asked him the other day, and he said, "I'll send you everything when I want you to post it." I said, "Well, I've seen it from your retailers that are getting it, and it's not a Maduro; it's an Ecuadorian Dark Habano. It is a very, very special blend. It's a size that I've never produced in any blend ever, and it was specifically done once he and I went through samples specifically for the club. I'm excited about it. It's got two main bands on it because he wanted our band, he wanted his band, and at the end of the day, he wanted it to stand out. So to me, it'll probably be the only cigar you'll ever smoke that has two main bands on it. but I couldn't be prouder. It's fun to work with him. They've been great with us, and I'm looking forward to that project hitting the market because I like the fact that you retailers are getting that from him, and yeah. That's what it's going to be. It's going to be a great joy to get the feedback, but I absolutely am in love with that blend and that size.
Great, great. And we're looking forward to it. Well, I want to thank you again, Robert, for joining us in smoking a cigar together, the conversation, and hearing just about Southern Draw. It's been a great time.
Hey, it was an honor. I hate that Sharon was in a little transit. She had to get back dental work or something. She broke a tooth, but she's with Ethan Jacob. But it was an honor. I don't think as clearly, and I apologize to everybody listening. I'm not as sharp as I used to be. I'm just not. I guess it's going to take a while, but it's good to get back in the saddle. You know, we'll just make the best of it. We're honored. We appreciate you guys out there in California supporting us, and we kind of look forward to more social time together and more releases and kind of getting to know each other a little better as your customers get the new stuff as well.
Yeah, definitely. And if you're watching, make sure you click on the link in the video, pick up a sampler pack. You will not be disappointed. Some of Southern Draw's greatest cigars within that pack. So thank you again, Robert. You continue to recover, and it's good to see you again. So take it easy.
Thank you, Brother Eric. Thank you all for watching.